Well, I don't want to read. Where I want to go is actually back in time. I want to go to the Mongolian Empire in the 13th century. In particular, Kublai Khan here, the grandson of Genghis Khan, was probably one of the greatest emperor of the ever. The Mongolian Empire is the largest empire which has ever inhabited Earth. And the empire went all over Asia. Now, this leads to a big problem of communication. Imagine we lived in Baghdad and we just made some cool mathematical discoveries and wanted to tell it to Kublai Khan. So we want to send a message, say, math is cool. Now, what they would do at this time, at that time, well, I'm not sure they would actually do that, but one thing that they could do is to have someone to tell someone to send a message. So you say someone to tell someone to repeat the message to another guy in the next city, who'd go to a second city and a third city and so on. So guys would be fine. You have several travelers who would repeat the message. And the message math is cool. The problem is that the message math is cool could be deformed. So it could get into math is good, but still okay. But then it could become cat is good, and then cat is food. And that's actually my theory of why Asian people eat cats. Now, this may seem like something, okay, it's because of humans. Humans are very bad at repeating. But it actually was pretty much the same problem that engineers and companies faced in the 1940s and 50s as they tried to improve communication. So back then, the telephone network in North America was developing very well, especially in the East Coast. Also in Europe, you had a lot of communication. So they tried to connect Europe and America together. So they basically sent a cable through the Atlantic Ocean. Now the trouble is that if you send a message from North America to Europe, then the message gets lowered and lowered. It gets weakened as it travels through the Atlantic. And at some point, it's so weak that it cannot be read anymore. Now, engineers had an idea of putting amplifiers. So you'd send a message in North America, and then you'd get amplified, and then re-amplified, and so on and so on. Now, the trouble with that is that the trouble with communication is really the perturbation of the signal that you get. It's called noise. It's kind of like you're in a nightclub and you're trying to shout something to the bartender, and there's so much noise that the message doesn't get through. That's kind of the same idea. If the noise is bigger than the message, then the message cannot be read. Now, if you send your message, the noise is very small. But when you amplify the message, you're also amplifying the noise. So both the message and the noise gets amplified. And at some point, the noise gets bigger than the message. And eventually, the message cannot be read in Europe. And there seems to be really a physical, fundamental limit to communication from America to Europe. If you don't use like extremely powerful signal, it seemed like you couldn't get a message from North America to Europe, at least to engineers at that time. And then came Claude Shannon. Now, I would argue that Shannon's idea is the greatest idea of the 20th century, the single greatest idea in all fields of the 20th century. His idea is the idea of bits. It's an awesome idea because it's simple, and it has very transformed the way we live. It has really solved an engineering problem. And it also has revolutionized the way we think. And plus, it's a one-syllable word, so it's very easy to learn. Now, I'm cheating a little bit because it's actually short for binary digits, but still, bits is cool. Why is it so awesome? Because bits are just zeros or ones. It's either zero or one. So it can be read precisely. Okay. So if you send your message now through the Atlantic, instead of having just an amplifier, you have something that reads the message first, that detects the zeros and the ones, and then amplifies just the signal, not the noise, and you can get rid of the noise because you've read the message. And by doing so, well, he has enabled us here in North America to communicate with Europe. The proof of that is obviously the internet and the web. So the ideas of Shannon's, well, they go way beyond that. It's a whole new understanding of what information and communication really mean. And I've actually read through his seminal paper, his original paper. That's the only original paper I've ever read. And it's very mind-blowing. So, spoiler alert, my next article on Science for All will be about Shannon's information theory. I'll talk about Science for All later. Don't worry, count on this. Okay, now the idea of information is so deep that it actually seems to be the root of all physics. So one of the most puzzling problems in theoretical physics is the study of black holes. And Stephen Hawking in particular argued that when something goes into the black hole, then because the black hole traps it forever, we cannot get this information anymore. This information is pretty much lost in our universe. And this seemed to, for Leonard Susskind and other theoretical physicists, it seemed to contradict a fundamental law of physics, which was never really stated before, but kind of seemed to be always there. It's the law of conservation of information. Now, after years of debates, which is called the war of black holes, it kind of seems they both agreed that Leonard Susskind was right, and that information is the most basic thing of all of physics. And now that you have descriptions of physics and of the universe, which are essentially based on this idea of information. That's how amazing the ideas of Shannon's are. Again. Okay, so now we talked about the basics of physics, but we really want to talk more about mathematics, so let's go to the basics of mathematics now. So let's go back to the basics. I guess it's Africa, right?